श्री पराशक्ति विद्यालय सीबीएसई क्लास 9 स्टैंडर्ड सब्जेक्ट इंग्लिश।
डियर स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू फाइन। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू फाइंड आउट द रियल कल्प्रिट्स इन लेसन 4 इन द किंगडम ऑफ फूल्स। बिफोर दैट लेट अस हैव अ रिकैप ऑफ द स्टोरी। द किंग ऑफ द किंगडम ऑफ फूल्स इज अ फूलिश मैन। ही ऑर्डर्स पीपल टू वर्क एट नाइट एंड स्लीप ड्यूरिंग डे, but he manages to keep food prices low. He is not able to solve even a simple crime. In an attempt to solve a crime, he investigates the owner of the house, that is the merchant, the bricklayer and the dancing girl. The dancing girl blames the goldsmith for delaying her order, because of which she had to walk up and down the street to his house. Now it's goldsmith's turn to be inquired by the king. Now I'll read the paragraph and explain the same. Poor thing, she is absolutely right, thought the king, weighing the evidence. We have got the real culprit at last. Get the goldsmith wherever he is hiding at once. The king's bailiff searched for the goldsmith, who was hiding in a corner of his shop. When he heard the accusation against him, he had his own story to tell. "My lord," he said, "I am a poor goldsmith. It's true I made this dancer come many times to my door. I gave her excuses because I couldn't finish making her jewelry before I finished the rich merchant's orders. They had a wedding coming and they wouldn't wait. You know how impatient rich men are. Who is this rich merchant who kept you from finishing this poor woman's jewelry, made her walk up and down, which distracted this bricklayer, which made a mess of his wall, which has now fallen on an innocent man and killed him? Can you name him?" Here, culprit means convict, impatient means restless, accusation means charge. The goldsmith was busy in making the urgent jewelry for merchant's father, so only he delayed the dancing girl's order that made her walk up and down, which distracted the bricklayer, which made a mess of the wall. Now I'll read the next two paragraphs. The goldsmith named the merchant, and he was none other than the original owner of the house whose wall had fallen. Now justice had come full circle, thought the king, back to the merchant. When he was rudely summoned back to the court, he arrived crying, "It wasn't me, but my father who ordered the jewelry. He's dead, I am innocent." But the king consulted his minister and ruled decisively, "It's true your father is the true murderer. He's dead, but somebody must be punished in his place. You have inherited everything from that criminal father of yours, his riches as well as his sins. I knew at once, even when I first set eyes on you, that you are at the root of this horrible crime. You must die." Consult means to discuss. Inherited, received as an heir at the death of precious father. Horrible means fearful. The goldsmith blames the merchant's father for the delay in his work. So the blame reaches its full circle, and the blame comes to the original merchant, saying like riches, he also inherited his father's sins as well. Now I'll read the next two paragraphs. And he ordered a new stake to be made ready for the execution. As the servants sharpened the stake and got it ready for the final impaling of the criminal, it occurred to the minister that the rich merchant was somehow too thin to be properly executed on the stake. He appealed to the king's common sense. The king too worried about it. "What shall we do?" he said, when suddenly it struck him that all they needed to do was to find a man fat enough to fit the stake. The servants were immediately sent all over the town looking for a man who would fit the stake, and their eyes fell on the disciple who had fattened himself for months on bananas and rice and wheat and ghee. Now I'll explain the paragraph. Stake means a wooden post that is pointed into the ground. A new stake was built for the execution, but the merchant was too thin to fit the stake. So the king's servants found the disciple who was brought to the place of the execution. He was selected for the execution because he had fattened himself for months on bananas and rice and wheat and ghee. Now I'll read the next paragraph. What have I done wrong? I am innocent. I am a sannyasi, he cried. That may be true, but it's the royal decree that we should find a man fat enough to fit the stake, they said, and carried him to the place of execution. He remembered his wise guru's words. This is a city of fools. You don't know what they will do next. While he was waiting for death, he prayed to his guru in his heart, asking him to hear his cry wherever he was. The guru saw everything in a vision. He had magic powers. He could see far and he could see the future as he could see the present and the past. He hurried at once to save his disciple who had got himself into such a scrape through love of food. Here, decree means a royal order. Vision means dream. The disciple was brought to the place of execution. He recalled his guru's warning. Then he prayed to his guru to save him. The guru saw everything in a vision. He had magic powers. The guru heard his prayer and came to his rescue at once. Now I'll read the next paragraph. As soon as he arrived, he scolded the disciple and told him something in a whisper. Then he went to the king and addressed him, O wisest of kings, who is greater, the guru or the disciple? Of course, the guru, no doubt about it. Why do you ask? Then put me to the stake first. Put my disciple to death after me. I'll explain the paragraph. The guru scolded his disciple for neglecting his warning. They decided a plan. And the guru asked the king to put him on the stake first and his disciple next. Now I'll read the other paragraphs. When the disciple heard this, he understood and began to clamor. Me first, you brought me here first, put me to death first, not him. The guru and the disciple now got into a fight about who should go first. The king was puzzled by this behavior. He asked the guru, why do you want to die? We chose him because we needed a fat man for the stake. You shouldn't ask me such questions. Put me to death first, replied the guru. Why? There is some mystery here. As a wise man, you must make me understand. Will you promise me to put me to death if I tell you? Asked the guru. The king gave him his solemn word. The guru took him aside out of the servant's earshot and whispered to him, Do you know why we want to die right now? The two of us, we have been all over the world, but we have never found a city like this or a king like you. That stake is the stake of God, of the God of justice. It's new. It has never had a criminal on it. Whoever dies on it first will be reborn as the king of this country. And whoever goes next will be the future minister of this country. We are sick of our ascetic life. It would be nice to enjoy ourselves as king and minister for a while. Now keep your word, my lord, and put us to death. Me first. Remember? Here, puzzled means something that you can't understand. Mystery means secret. Ascetic means saint. After hearing this, the disciple objected that he should be the one dying. He asked the king to put him on the stake first. They both got into fight about who should go first, both the guru and the disciple. The king was surprised and puzzled. The king asked the guru as to why did he want to die. The guru told the king that he told him secretly that the new stake was the stake of the God of justice, and whoever was executed on it first would be the future king of the country, and whoever was executed on it next would be the future minister of the country. Now I'll read the next three paragraphs. The king was now thrown into deep thought. He didn't want to lose the kingdom to someone else in the next round of life. He needed time. So he ordered the execution postponed to the next day and talked in secret with his minister. It's not right for us to give over the kingdom to others in the next life. Let's go on the stake ourselves and we'll be reborn as king and the minister again. Holy men do not tell lies, he said. And the minister agreed. So he told the executioners, we'll send the criminals tonight. When the first man comes to you, put him to death first. Then do the same to the second man. Those are my orders. Don't make any mistake. That night, the king and his minister went secretly to the prison, released the guru and the disciple, disguised themselves as the two, and as arranged beforehand with loyal servants, were taken to the stake and promptly executed. Disguise means to give new appearance. The king was a fool and believed this foolish story of the guru. He didn't want to lose his kingdom. He didn't want anyone else to become the next king. He told the executioners that he would send the criminals that night. The man who would come first should be put to death first, and the man who would come second should be put to death second. The king and the minister disguised themselves as the guru and his disciple and were executed. Now I'll read the last three paragraphs. When their bodies were taken down to be thrown to crows and vultures, the people panicked. They saw before them the dead bodies of the king and the minister. The city was in confusion. All night they mourned and discussed the future of the kingdom. Some people suddenly thought of the guru and the disciple and caught up with them as they were preparing to leave town unnoticed. We people need a king and a minister, said someone. Others agreed. They begged the guru and the disciple to be their king and their minister. It didn't take many arguments to persuade the disciple, but it took longer to persuade the guru. They finally agreed to rule the kingdom of the foolish king and the silly minister on the condition that they could change all the old laws. From then on, night would again be night and day would again be day, and you could get nothing for Addudu. It became like any other place. Here, vulture means a large bird that eats dead animals. Panicked means frightened. Mourn means express grief. Argument means logic. Persuade means to bring around. Condition means bet. The king and minister's true identity was discovered only when the dead bodies were taken down to be thrown to crows and vultures. People mourned and discussed the future of the kingdom. They begged the guru and his disciple to be their king and minister. The guru and the disciple ruled the kingdom and changed all the old laws. I think you like this story very much. From this story, we can understand that wisdom helps us to achieve many things in life, while foolishness can bring one's ruin. Now it's time to do your homework. Answer these questions. First one, what are the two strange things the guru and his disciple find in the kingdom of fools? Second one, why does the disciple decide to stay in the kingdom of fools? Is it a good idea? Third one, name all the people who are tried in the king's court and give the reasons for their trial. Fourth one, who is the real culprit according to the king? Why does he escape punishment? Fifth one, what are the guru's words of wisdom? When does the disciple remember them? Sixth one, how does the guru manage to save his disciple's life? That's all today, students. Thank you very much.